You know, sometimes I think that Ryan takes a particular pleasure in starting on time when he knows that I'm, like, still trying to run into the room. But he's out there laughing now. Oh, my goodness. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to PhotoJoseph's Photo Moment. If you want to skip past the pleasantries here as we get rolling, there will be a link down below where you can just click straight ahead to the actual official beginning of the show. While I finish here, getting ready and getting all set up for what is hopefully going to be a very interesting and educational photo moment as I go through and answer all the questions that have been coming up that I just didn't have time to answer previously. Because let's face it, a lot of comments coming through, a lot of great comments coming through, but man, I just have not had time to get into them all, and I thought it'd be better off if I do these as an actual part of the show. So I said last week that what I was going to try and do something new this week was make Monday the answering questions day. And this doesn't mean that I'm not going to answer questions on the comments directly. If they're simple questions, things I can answer very quickly, I will. But if there's something that requires a little bit more, then I want to take a little bit more time to get into it here live. That is my plan, and I'm sticking to it. So with all that said, let me get my comments up, which are flying by at the speed of comments here. And let's just see what's going on this morning. Burns Tech says, I'm not missing this one. Excellent. Burns, welcome. Good morning. Martin says, good morning. Bart Johnson Productions finally made it for the live broadcast. Awesome. Nice to have a day off once in a while. Hey, you know, days off are definitely nice things. You have to tell me what that's like sometime. Running your own business. Never get time off. Burns Tech, good afternoon from the East Coast. Don't forget your coffee. I know. Well, there's water in here. I don't drink coffee on this show. I know you find that impossible to believe, but this is water. Look, see? Clear. It's just water. I promise. Let's see here. What else we got? Time in Europe, 1730. Excellent. Good afternoon from the UK. Scott says, hello, hello, Scott. Hello, Sully. GH5 comes tomorrow, Scott. Really? Well, that is fantastic. Do you have an actual shipping notification? That's wonderful. Wow. Let's see here. Choi Wei Day is saying, hi from Singapore, 1230 in the morning. Hey, 1230 in the morning, middle of the night. Thank you so much for being here. That is pretty awesome. Good afternoon to everyone who is coming in from an afternoon time zone. GH5 expected this week, Martin Pitt. Excellent. Bart says, Sully, you're everywhere. Sully, are you everywhere? Are you omnipresent? John says, greeting from London. Sully says, really, mine doesn't ship till the 30th. Well, for those of you that are supposedly getting your GH5s tomorrow or soon, comment in here if you've got a shipping notification or if this is just your reseller saying you should have it tomorrow. It'd be great to know what's actually happening out there. Sully says, Joseph knows I pester him all the time. I'm always here at the live show. You are never a pester. It's wonderful having you on here. And let's see here. Hi from India. Wonderful. Jess, a minute late and comments are flying by. That they are. Hello, everyone. Choi Wei Day says, a happy G85 user. Excellent. Recommendations for lens? They're all awesome. Buy the Leica lenses. They're the best ones. If you just want the best, get the Leica glass. That's all there is to it. RD John Creations says, for the group expecting GH5s, when did you place the order? Mine was ordered January 29th and no notification yet. Martin, this is not vodka. If it was vodka, I'd be talking a lot more slowly. Maybe that's what I should start doing. It's too early in the show. If we did this at the end of the day and I started drinking at every show, then maybe I could slow things down a little bit for those who say I talk too fast. But then I might start to slow and I talk like this. That'd be no good. Probably not. I'd probably talk faster. It would be a fun show. Should we do it like a drink show? Bring some people in. We get drunk and talk photography. My friend Sean Bagshaw has been talking about that. Maybe we should bring him on. We should do that. All right. Greetings from Trinidad, Tobago. So incredible. From the Philippines. Martin says, Wex, I guess that's your retailer, sent me notice that stocks are expected Wednesday and mine should be with me Friday. Fantastic. Anorama expects a ship date of March 30th. Okay. Hi from Germany and excellent. And yes, a drinking show. Yeah. This is like a really bad idea. Okay. Let's do this thing. This might be long because there are a lot of questions here. Yeah, you can cycle. Yeah, this is going to take a minute. So let's just get this thing rolling. Good morning and welcome to PhotoJoseph's Photo Moment, the first live daily photo show on the YouTubes every weekday, 9:30 a.m. Pacific time. If you're not watching this live, try to tune in live sometime. The comments are flying by fast and furious, and that is part of what makes this show so much fun. As I said at the start of the show, in case you skip past that bit, we are doing a Q&A. This is the first of what will probably be a weekly Monday series where I answer the questions that have come up in the comments on the videos that were just a little bit too lengthy for me to answer by text because, let's face it, I got work to do too. I can't be on comments all the time as much as I would love to. So what I've done is I've marked the comments everybody who had a question that I wanted to address here, I just pasted in a boilerplate thing that says your, what did I say, your, it says I'll address your question live right here, and it links to this video on PhotoJoseph's Photo Moment and then today's date. So what I've done is I've just searched for that today's date on here. That brings up all of the questions that I've tagged for today's comments. And I think what we'll do as well is Ryan is going to copy and paste all of these questions into the comments. We're not gonna time stamp them because that's just way too much work, but we will at least post the questions in there so that you can find your question somehow. I don't know how this is gonna work. We're making this up as we go, but I think it's a good idea. So, and let's see here, what have we got here? people are all on to the drinking show idea. Dieter, let's see here, Jess is participating in that. You got your drink up, excellent. RD. John says, Sean, if we're drinking bourbon, it is. I don't know who Sean is. That's not me. If you're talking about Sean Robinson, he would love to be on the show with a bourbon in his hand. I can guarantee you that. Okay, let's get it started. So first question is actually going back a couple of weeks. Once we're caught up, this will be just a weekly thing. All right, this is a simple one. Do you have any samples using the Panasonic XLR1 professional microphone adapter? I'm wondering if it's worth selling my H4N Zoom to buy the Panasonic instead. Okay, so just to clarify, the XLR1 adapter is the adapter that goes on top of the GH5 that allows dual XLR inputs. It has I don't have one, but I did play with one a little bit in Florida when we were out there for the Luminary Summit. It's a great device. It allows you to have pro level audio coming in, but still captured straight to the card. You can split the audio from XLR 1 and 2 to separate channels so that you have clean sources for two separate pieces of audio. So in that regards, it is fantastic. It certainly beats recording your audio separately, which is what, this question came from Andy Arts, which is what Andy Arts is doing with the H4N Zoom. So the H4N Zoom is a dedicated audio recorder. You plug in a couple of XLRs, records that, and then on your camera, you would just record scratch audio just using the internal microphone and then use in Final Cut or Premiere or whatever you're using, sync them up in post, which is a fantastic solution. And frankly, that's how pretty much all high-end production is done. But if your camera has the XLR inputs, high quality input as the XLR1 adapter gives you, then honestly, I would much prefer to do that than record separately and sync in post. It's actually several steps less, right? You don't have to copy from a second card. You don't have a second file to deal with. You don't have to merge it. You don't have to check your sync. It just is there and it works. So I think it's a great solution. Now, that said, if you're the super paranoid type and you wanna have a separate recording, you wanna have that the H4N Zoom recording separately so that if something happens to the video, you've got a separate audio or you just want multiple audio tracks, then you may still wanna hold on to that H4N, but there's a couple different ways to do it. But I think it's much less necessary now with that XLR1 adapter. So hopefully that answers that question. All right, let's see here. Here we go. Okay. SC Toronto says, hi, Joseph. Sorry to bother. Got a couple more questions regarding quality. Are we talking about the GH5 here? Oh, no. Okay. So these questions are going to be all over the map. This question is linked to my video. We'll put a link to it right here on the VidiU Pro. That's the Teradek VidiU. It's a dedicated hardware streaming device. Next time, I think maybe I'll group these together by topic. Nah, that's no fun. This is about that VidiU Pro, and this chap, SC Toronto 2003 Girls OPDL, I think it's a soccer team or something, was asking about the quality on this, and it just got to be too big, so I said, we'll take this on the air. So the question here says, as we will always be streaming to Facebook from a hotspot connected from my cell phone, do you recommend leaving both the audio and video settings on mobile on the VidiU? So he's streaming live, of a live event, soccer game, I think it was, with whatever camera and the VidiU Pro. And it says the range we're getting on the test is a low side of 255 kilobit as high as 498 kilobit. Okay, that ain't nothing. That is really, really low bandwidth. You wanna be in the multiple megabit bandwidth to be doing live streaming. If you're that low, that's barely even SD. I don't think you'd even get a good reliable SD stream, much less an HD stream. Now, Facebook is limited to 720p, so that in this case is working to your advantage, but I would seriously be looking at your connection. Now, the VidiU Pro, one of the really cool things about it is, and I've never tried this, and I have had my own problems with the VidiU, but one of the cool things about it is you can actually gang multiple cellular connections together to get increased bandwidth. I don't know how, I've never done it, so I can't say how exactly it works, but I know that that's a feature of it. So that's might be something you should look into, because that is way too low of a connection. You wanna be on LTE, you wanna have at least a few megabit, if not a good solid 10 megabit connection to be streaming HD. Just, yeah, you really want faster bandwidth than that. The question continues, I'd initially set the output from my Canon to 1080p, should I drop it to 720? Yes, drop the output from your camera to match what you're streaming, because then the encoder doesn't have to transcode quite as much. That should take it should take some of the effort off of the VidiU. So give it a 720p signal if that's all that you're streaming. Remember, the VidiU will capture your show internally. Right, it's got a little memory card, but it captures what it's broadcasting. So if you're sending it 1080p but broadcasting 720p, it's only going to capture 720p. Now the only caveat to this would be if you want to capture in the camera, if the camera allows you to record and output simultaneously on the HDMI. A lot of cameras do not do this. I have no idea what your Canon will do, but a lot of them do not. On the Panasonic side, I think it's only the GH series that do, the higher end series that will do this, let you simultaneously record and output over the HDMI. In this case, if you want to capture your 1080p signal in the camera, you probably can't simultaneously output a 720p signal on the VidiU. If you're shooting with Lumix, one of the things you could do is you could capture internally at 4K and output over the HDMI 1080p, but you couldn't do 1080p and then 720 out. They don't work that way. So that's something to think about there. Okay, and then frame output from the camera can be set to 59. Since you're shooting soccer, doesn't make sense. If you had massive bandwidth, yes, but you don't, so no, because you're gonna end up losing frames. Throw less data at the VidiU, not more data, because your bandwidth is so incredibly low. And let's see here. Lastly, in the VidiU app settings under Facebook, what should the frame rate set at when taking the button into consideration? So set your frame rate for Facebook to basically match whatever your bandwidth is. If you're really only gonna get this 500K, you're gonna go really low. You're not gonna be doing a full stream, full bandwidth, full frame rate show. Sorry, you need more bandwidth. That's really what it is. If you get the bandwidth, then you can go maximum on Facebook, which is 720p at 30 frames per second. But if you don't have the bandwidth, you can't do it. Don't even try. You'll end up dropping frames and people will abandon the show, because believe me, people would much rather see a low resolution show than a show that stops every couple of seconds for buffering. Okay, there are a ton more comments flying by. Let me take a look at these real quick and then jump back into the questions. Let's see here. Question from Bernstech. Will the XLR1 be ready to ship with the GH5, or is that going to be later? As far as I know, it's going to be ready. I haven't heard anything otherwise. So I don't know otherwise. I haven't heard that it won't be, so I'm going to assume that it is. But that is an assumption, and you know what they say about that. Let's see here. People talking about the prices being higher overseas. That's often the way. It's usually has to do with taxes. That's way out of my realm of expertise. So sorry to hear that. Not a thing I can do about it, of course. Let's see here. Any other questions I want to hit on here? Prices. Wow, this is interesting. Danmark Digger is saying in Denmark, the GH5 price is 2,500 euros. In Germany, it's only 2,000 euros. You have to drive to Germany to buy one. Danish tax kills. Well, so there you go. It's the Danish tax. It's not Panasonic. Okay. Let's see here. A comment about Vlog. Vlog, as I understand, is a $100 add-on. That is correct. It is not built in. It is not included. The only place that it will be included is in Australia, and this has something to do with local Australian Panasonic kind of going off the reservation and doing something on their own. It is not the way that official Panasonic worldwide is doing it. It's a $100 add-on to get Vlog. No idea why Australia did it that way, but they did, and unless you live in Australia, then you have to pay for that add-on. Okay, let's see here. People talking about tripods. We're going to skip those comments for now. B&H comments. Thomas is asking, got any tips on using the GH4 with the Atomos Ninja Flame? About to use them for the first time the week of March 27th. Okay, I'll give you one tip, because they're awesome. The Atomos Ninja Assassins, Shogun, Flames, all those things are awesome. Make sure, and I'm not saying this from experience or anything, but make sure that you don't have the on-camera data, the on-screen display data being output over HDMI. Because you look at your camera screen and you see all these overlays, your histogram, your countdown to how many seconds you have left of recording, all that stuff. It's all there on your screen. And so that's what you're used to looking at all the time. And then you look at your Ninja screen, you see the same thing. And you don't even think about it because, you know, that's what's there. But what's on the Ninja screen is what's getting recorded. So if you see that on-screen data coming over and it's coming from the camera and not from the Ninja itself, turn it off. Or you're going to end up with a bunch of footage with all this crap on top of it that you can't use. I never made that mistake ever in my life. Okay, there's, let's see, any other questions in here? No, all right, we're going to scoop up. Do you have any information on how the GH5 will work tethered shooting for Lightroom or Capture One Pro? Okay, tethered shooting for the GH5 is coming in a firmware update in the summer, I think. That is specifically for Lightroom and that format. I have no idea if it will work with Capture One. I've only heard about Lightroom. I think that Capture One uses a different protocol. So if that's true, it may not work, but it will work to Lightroom. That's what it's being written for, which Lightroom's using basically a universal protocol. Former Lumix cameras used a different protocol. No idea why. One of the most annoying things ever. They're fixing that. They will have the proper standard universal protocol in the GH5 with a firmware update that's coming. Whether Capture One is using that protocol or not is a different story that I don't know. All right, next question from PhaseGamer. Is the ISO brightness the same at 3200 and 6400 on the GH5 as the Canon T2i? If so, then this blows my T2i out of the water. So he's looking at low ISO sample footage that, or high ISO, low light sample footage that I put out. Have not done any comparisons. I think technically that the ISO readout should be the same, but this gets into one of those weird micro four thirds versus full frame APS-C sensor things. The aperture is not the same aperture. Is the ISO the same ISO? I don't know. And the only reason I put this question up here is so that I could say, A, I haven't compared to the Canon, so, and I'm not going to, so I can't answer it that way. But B, there might be, and there might not be a difference between ISOs as you go across these different sensors. A month ago, I would have said there is no difference, but I have been ridiculed on the internet for claiming that about aperture and have understood that my understanding of that needs to expand a little bit. So when it comes to ISO, I'm just going to say, I don't know. That's going to be my answer and I'm sticking to it. Okay, comment on the Live One Light video that we did. That was the one where we talked about the color matching, color checker, passport, match that in there. Dieter was asking, would it help, would that color checker passport help to make match different cameras if the cameras are different, to basically match the look between them? Yes, absolutely. It doesn't mean that you're going to get an absolutely identical match because there could still be inherent differences that can't be matched precisely. But if you have two different cameras, two different manufacturers, and they look very different, obviously, if you run them both through color checker passports, you should get a much more similar, much more matching looking image. So that's something you can definitely do. And those work for both video and for stills. Video, you have to use plugins in Final Cut or Premiere to make that whole thing work. Well, just like you would in Lightroom, use a plugin for it. I've never really done it with video, but you can. Okay, next question from Jacobo Castro Cristo says, thanks for the video. Well, this is another Lumix GH5 video. I think this is the interview with Sean. I'm currently shooting video on a 70D and I'm thinking about changing to the Lumix GX85 with a speed booster. Is it a good idea to make this change or should I wait for Canon to make a small 4K camera that I could actually pay for so I can use all my Canon lenses natively? Okay, I know I'm gonna get flamed for this, but I wouldn't hold my breath for Canon. They've been so slow on developing anything of interest and their current 4K offerings are crazy high end, very good cameras. The C300, really, really good cameras, but these are cinema filmmaker cameras, not normal photographer cameras. Yeah, there's my answer on that. I don't know why the speed booster is a necessity to you, but look, GX85 video looks beautiful. Look at, here, this will be your sample. Go to watch my video that I did in New Orleans. This is a commercial video for Panasonic that I did in New Orleans about a year ago. We'll link to it right here. And this is a demo of the GX85. And you'll see on there, some of it shot on the GH4. Anything where I'm on camera and you see me with the camera, that shot on a GH4. All the beauty shots that are not me in them, those are shot on the GX85. So watch that and you'll see how good that footage looks. Gorgeous stuff, all 4K. Okay, let's see here. Next one, this is a comment on one of the GH5 sample footage videos. Let's see here. Weston Zimmerman says, hey Joseph, love your videos on the GH5, thank you. Super helpful in the middle of switching gears from hobby to pro. Good for you, congratulations. I'm shopping for my first high-end camera. My work is maybe 60% video, 40% stills. I want slash need high frame rate for slow motion.
Okay.
And still want the ability to capture DSLR quality stills. Excellent. Love the features available in this camera, the GH5, but being I have no real world experience with it and wondering if you would confirm my instinct that the GH5 is the right camera, or would you point me in another direction? Okay, GH5 will be great if you're doing high frame rate, because it is, of the GH5, of the Lumix lineup, it is the one that has the highest frame rate at a given resolution. So at 4K, we get full 60p, 60 frames per second, which is half speed if you're doing slow motion. In 1080p, so full HD, 180 frames per second. What was that, 5 or 6 times slow motion? I forget the math now. It depends on what frame rate you're conforming to. But 180 frames per second at 1080p, that is fantastic. I don't know, and I could be, I'm not saying that there isn't, I'm saying I don't know if there's any other cameras out there in this price range that go that high in full HD. So you might want to research that a bit, but the GH5 is the first of the Lumix to do that. It is the highest frame rate. So if high frame rate is something you're looking for, then that is definitely one to look at. The comment, the video that you commented on was my one on focus pulling, it looks like. It's so ridiculous. The icons they put on here are so low resolution. It's really hard to see. But watch the video that I posted on slow motion and just search PhotoJoseph GH5 slow motion and you'll find it. And there you'll see kind of what the 180 frame per second can do. Pretty, pretty slick. Let's see here. ClouderTV is asking, when I was talking about the Manfrotto tripod. Oh, it's right here. I can't grab it. But he was asking when I did the little video on the Manfrotto tripod, if you can remove the fluid head and put a ball head on it. No, that particular tripod, the head is not designed to be removed. It's a lower end, you know, this is your little video tripod. If you want a tripod with a ball head, either buy a bigger tripod where you can swap heads on, or buy two cheaper tripods, one for a ball head and one for your fluid head. But this one, that one that I talked about, is called the Be Free, you can see it right here, Be Free Live. It does not, the head does not come off of that. All right, next up, back to Lumix camera, Lumix GH5 stuff. This comment was attached to the unboxing video that I did just a week or so ago. Asked, does the GH5 work with high speed sync lights? Okay. Excellent. This is a great question, and I will be doing some demos with this for sure in the upcoming future here as I do more testing with the GH5, more sample content. High speed sync lights. Short answer: yes, absolutely. The Panasonic lights, the 580 and 360. I think those are the model numbers. Could be wrong, but I think that's right. Those strobes do have a high speed sync mode. It's just like high speed sync on your Canon or Nikon or anybody else who does high speed sync. Over a certain shutter speed, and I believe it's 250th of a second, you enter the realm of high speed sync. And what happens is on the camera, say you're in regular flash mode, you're in manual exposure mode, and you have your manual exposure set to 125th or whatever. And you crank it up to 250, that's as high as it goes. You try to go higher, it won't go higher. You have to go into high speed shutter sync, high speed sync. Once you go into high speed sync, you can go all the way up to 8,000th of a second and shoot with strobe. The way that it works is kind of crazy cool. I don't want to get into the whole thing now, but basically high speed sync works where normal shutter, your shutter opens, flash fires, shutter closes. High speed sync, the flash is pulsing at some massively high speed. It looks like a single flash to you, but it's pulsing at a massively high speed. If you looked at it on an oscilloscope, you'd see it. And this allows the shutter to open and close and capture a full burst. It's a little bit more complicated than that, but that's basically the gist of it. Really, really cool. So yes, the answer to the question, does GH5 work with high speed sync, is simply yes. A lot of people have asked about the metabones speedbooster. Can I test? Okay, here's the update on that. I emailed metabones, right? Metabones is the company, speedbooster is the product. I emailed metabones the first time probably a month ago. Got no response. Emailed again, got no response. Found another email address, emailed them again. Finally got a response that said, we have not tested the GH5 with the speedbooster yet. I'm like, no, I know that. If you read the email, I was saying, hey, I've got one, I'm a luminary, I have my hands on one, I got a lot of questions from my lovely audience about this. Would you guys be interested in working with me? Send me one, let's test it, let's see what works, what doesn't. So I wrote back and I said that. And they basically said, we'll be getting one in a few weeks or a month and we'll test it then. All right, guys. So Metabones has zero interest in using me as a conduit to educate you about the speed booster. I think it's a fabulous product. People seem to love it. I've never used one, but apparently that's going to continue because they have no interest. And I am not going to request one from B&H to stick it on a camera that may not work without Metabones even offering me that level of support to say, hey, let's work on this together. I said, I'll get it from B&H. All I want is someone there to talk to walk me through it. Let's make sure this thing is working right. They have no interest in that. So my hands are washed of this one for now. We'll come back to that once they have decided that it actually works or doesn't work. And then I will go ahead and get one. But for now, that's their loss. Okay, back to GH5 sample footage. This looks like, yeah, this is on the slow motion one. Ah, this is a great question. Okay, Matt Kaiser says, hey, I'm a little confused. How does shoot at 60p for a 30p timeline differ from VFR mode? I don't quite understand VFR or the timeline concept, so any explanation is great. Okay, so this came up because in my sample video, in the slow motion sample video, I had a couple of different types of samples on there. I had standard VFR, which stands for variable frame rate, and then I had samples at 60p slowed down to 30p. So here's the primary difference. So VFR stands for variable frame rate. Put that out first. When you set the camera into a mode that is VFR compatible, you'll see that when you're going through the menu, it'll say, you know, at this 1080p HD mode, VFR is enabled. As soon as you change your speed, your variable frame rate, as soon as you change your frame rate, anything from what is native, so if your native was 30 or your native was 24, whatever it was, as soon as you change it, you lose audio recording. Okay, so this is very, very important. You are not recording audio when you're in a VFR mode. And this makes sense, right? If you're shooting at 180 frames per second, you were recording audio at the same time, when you played it back, you're really slow. So that wouldn't work. So it doesn't. And I think that it doesn't also because of processing needs. There's a lot of processing happening to capture at 180 frames per second or 90 or whatever you've set it to. So it just doesn't record audio. So audio is gone when you're shooting VFR. So there's that. Then he's asking about comparing it to 60p and my comment or title or whatever I put in there about shooting 60p for a 30p timeline. So here's what can happen. And this tip, I wish I remembered who had posted this initially. Someone had posted this and I went, oh my God, this is so obvious and brilliant. It's amazing. I'm totally gonna do this from now on. Let's say that your project is gonna be 30p. You're outputting 30p and it could be 4K. You're outputting 4K, 30p. That's what you're gonna publish. You can shoot at 4K 60p, which will record audio because this is full on 4K 60p with audio. No, this isn't VFR, this isn't variable frame rate. It's 60p with audio. You can shoot at that. Drop that onto your timeline and it will show up, it'll play back at 30. It will basically throw away every other frame. And this happens automatically. You just drop it on your timeline, you get your audio, it plays back in real time. It's totally normal. It looks the same as if you had shot it in 30. But you have an extra frame in between every frame that is not being used. The advantage of this is you can conform that to 30p, which means take those 60 frame and play it out frame per frame so that your 60p playback on a 30p timeline becomes half speed, right? Because now you've got double as many frames as you need, you're playing it back at normal speed of 30p, so it plays back half the speed of where it started. So this gives you a half speed or 2x slow motion, depending on which way you want to look at it, natively. So if you're shooting 60p, with audio, and then every once in a while you see a shot like, oh, this would be beautiful with just a little bit of slow motion. I just want to slow that down a little bit. You can go to 60p. You're not adding any frames. The software is not interpolating. It's not adding frames. These are frames shot by the camera. And so you have a perfect 2x slow motion. Beautiful, beautiful stuff. And this is a really great way to work if you've got the storage for this, because basically it allows you to at any time go to half speed slow motion and have perfect playback, not adding frames, with what you shot out of the camera. There are other disadvantages shooting 60p, like you have to shoot at a higher frame rate, so that may not really work with the style of what you're shooting. So there's things to consider there, but that's the difference. So 60p conformed to a 30p timeline versus VFR variable frame rate of what that means. Okay, and the term conform is just a fancy video editing term for taking your video file that's one speed or one frame rate rather and playing it back at a different one. If I take a 90 frame per second video and I put it on a 24 frame per second timeline, I'm conforming that to 24. That's all that means. The camera, when you play, when you capture in VFR, if you capture 180 frame per second, it automatically conforms it to 30p or 24p, whatever the camera is set to, so that when it plays back, you see it played back in slow motion. If it didn't do that, then you'd see it play back in real time at 180 frames per second. But that's not what you want. You want to see it play back at 24 or 30 frames per second, slow motion. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. Hopefully that helped answer that question. All right, I'm gonna take a look at the comments here real quick before I continue on with the questions up here. Let's see here. I need a bookmark on this on these comments here. All righty. Let's see here. B&H is one day shipping to me since they're only 3 hours away. Whatever. Burns. Show off. Vlog free in Australia. Yep. Talking about that. Oh, and someone commenting, Trevor's commenting that EU gets lens bundles. Yeah, it's the lens bundles things. Apparently, it's a pretty good savings. I think it was like a $500 savings by getting the camera and the lens. It was the Leica 12 to 60 lens bundled together. I don't know why it's not being bundled in the US. We asked Sean from Panasonic about it. Basically, he said it just comes down to how people buy. It's buying patterns. For the most part, people in the US apparently prefer to buy separately than buy bundles. And obviously, adding a bundle in addition to the separate things, this is another SKU, it's another box, it's a whole other thing that has to be managed. So in the effort of simplifying it, they don't have the bundle. Can't say that I agree with it. If it's a $500 savings, that sounds like a pretty good reason to do a bundle to me, but whatever, let's just wait. And that could change. You never know. Anything could change. Okay. Oh, Burns Tech is saying, Joseph, if I click your affiliate link to buy something else, will you still get credit for the link? Yes, and thank you. So the way that affiliate links work is when you click on an affiliate link on Amazon, one of my Amazon links, B&H links, whatever, Adorama links, it basically drops a cookie into your browser that says, hey, you came from PhotoJoseph's affiliate link, he's gonna get credit. Not just for that thing, but anything else that you buy in that session. And the cookies usually live for a day or 2 days. It just depends on the company, how they've set it up. And so if you click on my link for a GH5 and then you go and buy a washing machine from Amazon, I'll actually get credit for that washing machine, which is awesome. Thank you, because those things are expensive. So I appreciate that. If you don't wanna give me credit, and that's totally cool, you can clear your cookies and that will clear that out. Or if you click on somebody else's affiliate link, it'll replace my cookie, right? So if you click on my link and then go click on somebody else's and then buy the GH5, they're gonna get credit for it, not me. So that's how affiliate links work. So once you click on it, anything you buy from that store within the next day or so will get credit to me unless you deliberately go in and clear that out. Or after a day or so, and then it just cleared out automatically. The cookie expires. Cool, so there you go. Thank you for asking that. You know, it's, they add up. I've never made what I'd consider a lot of money or real money off of affiliate links, but they add up. And you know, a little bit here and there, a little bit here, every little bit puts this whole thing together and keeps the show on the air. Okay, let's see here. Next up, we already talked about tethering. Any way to get the GH5 with, any way to use the GH5 with USB power bank? No, because the GH5 cannot be powered through the USB port. I know that's, it's unfortunate. Sean explained why in the interview video. I don't know that I totally buy it, if I'm honest. I think that the GH5 could be powered by an external power source on the USB, but that's the way it is. So, sorry. Okay. And you can run it from, you can run it though off of power. I put a comment, I put a link in, when was the video? A few videos ago. You know, we'll put it again here. I'll drop it into the comment, into the description here. There is a wall power source that you can buy for the GH4 and of course the GH5, same power source that you pop into the battery port on there and then you plug into the wall so you can run it indefinitely. I've got one running on my GH4 over here. If I'm ever shooting with the camera in the studio, that's how I do, so you don't have to swap out batteries. It's totally worth doing, absolutely. So we'll put a link to that down below. Ryan, don't forget, we'll put a link to that down below. Okay, let's see here. More comments, focal length, kind of image stabilization, a lot of commentary, not questions on here, so I'm just scrolling past that. Bart Johnson saying that Dan Chung from New Shitter and PGN did test a speed booster on the GH5. I have heard of some of these tests going on. They had some hiccups on the beta firmware to pair, but apparently worked when the firmware was updated. Awesome. So that's very good to hear as well. Metabones probably wants to have the in-house control over any issues. I'm sure they do, but you know, they could still work with me, but that's okay. I'm small fish. Royal Grom saying, I have the problem, but on the Pentax KS1 DSLR, I can easily shoot my sky, but on the Lumix GX7, I get black image or gray. No details or anything. Okay, I have no idea. It sounds like a massively under or overexposed image, because obviously you can shoot skies with the Lumix camera, so I'm not quite sure what's going on there. Maybe put more of a description in as a proper comment later, and I can respond to it another time. Burnstex says, I don't know of any camera that records audio during VFR. You would have to record audio separately on a recorder or overdub. So there you go. RD John Creations. So many questions, not enough answers. Which video mode are you shooting in? Oh, that he's responding to the problem about the Pentax. So yes, great. Thank you, RD John. Take over that for me. Awesome. Sean says, I'm 71 subscribers away from 4K. Wow. Thanks for letting me know, Sean. That is killer awesome. Wow, we're going to hit 4K this week. Sweet. Does the GH5 have eye autofocus? Meaning when you put your eye up to it, does it autofocus? Yes. Meaning does it look for the eye and autofocus on that? Yes. So yes to both of those, whichever it was you're actually asking. Benjamin says, Joseph is the man. Why, thank you, Benjamin. Make sure you all sub. Why, thank you. I'm working hard to put out some of the highest quality content on this category on YouTube. Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Okay. Man, okay. Any thoughts on using a tilt plate on a slider? Don't quite know what you mean by that, Bernstech. Tilt plate. I don't know what you mean by that, so please clarify. It's just maybe it's something I'm not familiar with. Oh, Serge is asking from Latvia. He says, any luck in getting your lens unstuck? So Serge gave me a tip, which we're trying right now. He said, stick the lens in the freezer, the metal will contract and see if it works. In fact, the lens is in the freezer. In fact, Ryan, please bring me my frozen lens and let's see if Serge's tip has helped me. It's been in there for about an hour now. We'll see what happens. We're gonna give that a try. Let's see here. And all right, you guys are talking about heads. That's great. You can talk about the tilt heads over there. That's awesome. Thank you very much. It's so cold. Okay, here we go. Let's try this. Nope. Still no joy. Man, that is one cold hunk of metal. Nope. Thank you, Sarah, for the wonderful suggestion. Sadly, that wasn't it. So that is now one frozen chunk of lens. I emailed the company. They haven't written me back. I asked them if I can send this to them for repair. I'm so bummed about this. Can't believe I did this. Okay. Next up. Ooh, all kinds of great questions here. Okay, we're going to jump off of the comments on there and go back to the questions at hand. Next question. Saw that. Unless I missed it, I'm not seeing what you're... Oh. Hey, Ryan, bring me the GH5, please. I left my GH5 at home. Don't bring me the GH5. It's not there. Laurendet was asking where the remote plugs in on the GH5. Ryan, bring me a GH4. There's one out there somewhere. Find a camera. He'll bring it to me and I'll show you. It's in the same place. He's asking where the remote plugs in, and we're talking about this kind of a remote here. That's on camera. This kind of remote here. So we'll get that. I'll show it to you on the GH4. It's the same place in the GH5. Okay. This is a great one. So DMM, this is about the GH5. This is attached to the unboxing video. Could you explain, please, about crop factor on the GH5? I know the crop factor is 2, same as the GH4, but comparing of these two cameras with similar lenses shows the GH5 has a more wide angle.
Is the 4 on the slider, where's the 5?
But no, the 5's at home, you missed it. But the 4 on the slider, just bring me the whole slider, that's fine. Where was I? But comparing of these two cameras, GH4 and GH5, a similar lens shows the GH5 has more wide-angle views. My question is, has the GH4, GH5 crop factor changed? If so, what is the size of it? Thank you.
You're welcome.
Excellent question. Okay. Remote. Let's see. This is on. Is this one on? Oh, why isn't that camera on? Why isn't that camera on? Wake up. Oh, probably because I didn't turn it on. It's a pretty good reason. Okay, let's turn that guy on. Let's focus that guy. Focus. There we go. Okay, switch over to this. So let's pick this up a little bit. There we go, right there. So you're gonna find the exact same location on the GH5. You can actually see right there, it says the word remote. So this is, there's your shutter button right there. You see the little door in there says remote. Pop this guy open. And it is a, 2.5 millimeter size, I think. Come here, get out of the way. There we go. I think that's a 2.5 millimeter size. Connection. So that's what is on the other end of this guy here. Let me untangle this thing. There we go. This guy here. So that's the official Panasonic remote. All it does is focus and take a picture. It's, you know, super low tech, but it works. Plug that in there and then off you go. So there is the answer to that question. It's exactly the same place on the GH5. Okay. Get that out of the way. So the crop factor question. No, the crop factor has not changed on the GH5. It's still a micro four thirds sensor. Sensor is the exact same size as the GH4. It is higher resolution, but that has nothing to do with this question. It is the same size, so it is still a 2x crop factor, meaning when you pick up a lens, frozen or not, and it says 25 millimeter on the tin, you get a 50 millimeter equivalent in the world of full frame sensors. So that's what that is. The reason that you're seeing that you get a wider field of view on the GH5 than you do off the GH4 is because on the GH4, it was cropping into the sensor to shoot 4K. So if this was your sensor, and if you're just shooting still pictures, you're using the whole sensor. On the GH4, when you shot 4K, it actually used an exact pixel for pixel 4K punch-in of the sensor, which meant that if you were shooting 1080p, okay, if you're shooting straight HD, it used the whole sensor and scaled it down. So then if you switched to 4K mode, suddenly it punched into the sensor a little bit. That's the way that the GH4 worked. And this all had to do with processing power. Processing this whole thing in what is essentially 5K-ish of data and scaling down to 4K was too much for the processor to handle. In the GH5, though, that is no longer the case. The GH5 now has the processing power, so it shoots the entire the entire width of the sensor, not the height, but the entire width of the sensor when you're in 4K mode and scales that down to 4K, the 4K output that you get. Same thing at 1080p. So if you're shooting 1080p or 4K on the GH5, it is using the full width of the sensor and then scaling it down to the size that you've requested. This means that it means two things. A, you no longer get a field of view shift when you go from 1080p to 4K, which was crazy annoying. Because it happened, I ran into this on this camera right here when I had the GH4 here, and I'd switch them because some of this broadcast I do in, well, the broadcast I do in HD and some recordings I do in 4K, so I always had to reset the camera. That's no longer a case. Plus, it also means that when you're shooting 4K, you're getting the full width of your lens just as you are when you're shooting stills. You're no longer getting punched into that a little bit. So super great. So that is one of those small yet insanely awesome and important features of the GH5. Hey, last question. What's the difference between the cheap and expensive 35 to 100 millimeter? Besides image quality, are there other benefits worth the extra money? So I think you're talking about the 35 to 100 f2.8, which is a fixed aperture f2.8, and then there's a 35 to 100 f4 to 5.6, which is tiny, tiny lens. Okay, Ryan, see if you can find this. In my drawer of lenses, there is a 35 to 100. You should see it on the back of the cap. It's a tiny lens, and it should be on the right-hand side. See if you can find that. And just bring that to me. And then I've got the bigger one here and I'll compare them side by side. So it is a massively, massively faster lens. It's a better quality glass lens. It is the F2.8 one. It is designed for video, the F2.8 one. It is, I mean, just overall, everything about it is superior. It costs more, it's bigger, it's better. The other one is just a small, lightweight, very portable, small little zoom lens. And it's a great little lens. Frankly, if you're going for a really lightweight travel kit, sweet. Yes, that's it, awesome. If you're looking for a really lightweight travel kit, that is. That's a 35 to 100. Same as, this is gonna fall over, I know it. Let me tighten down there we go. Compared to this. So there's the two lenses, both 35 to 100s. I would put that camera on, but I just took this lens off of it, so I can't. Both 35 to 100s. This is a fixed f2.8. This one is a, let's see if I got the numbers right, 4 to 5.6. Yeah, nailed it. So that is a f4 to 5.6. And this one, when you zoom, I think it, it does a little telescoping thing. This one does not. So, but this is a killer little lens. Obviously, you don't get as shallow depth of field as you do with this one, but if you're willing to sacrifice a little bit of depth of field, it is still a very good lens. Now, don't get me wrong, this is still a very good sharp lens. If you're looking for just a super lightweight travel kit, this is a pretty sweet lens to have. Also on this note, there's another lens, you know, the Nocticron, like the badass lens, right? The 42.5mm f1.2 lens. There's a 42.5mm f1.8 lens. It's like the same size as this. And it's still a very, very good lens. So again, that super lightweight travel kit, you grab yourself a GX85, this, that little 42, a couple other lenses, man, you're talking about a super lightweight, awesome, awesome travel kit. So there's that. So there's the difference between those two 35 to 100 lenses. And that is the extent of the questions that I had labeled up here. That only took 45 minutes, that wasn't too bad. All right, let's see what else is going on in the comments, and then we're gonna knock this off and get back to work. Alrighty, let's see, I'm scrolling up. I think I was somewhere around here. We're just going to hope that that's right. More comments responding to RD.John. That's great. Thank you guys for taking care of those questions on there. Really appreciate that. And, Sully says, sorry, I haven't been chatting since stuffing my face with a salami sandwich. God, that sounds good. I need a salami sandwich. Sully's making better decisions than the rest of us, probably. And now I want to eat a sandwich. See, look at that. Man, talking about food, that's totally not fair. Okay, Brent asks, Joseph, when using the XL1, is there a way to only keep audio meters always on screen? Don't know what you mean by only. I mean, just the audio meters and nothing else? I don't think so. You might be able to customize that, but I'm not sure. You definitely can have the audio meters on screen, obviously. I think they're bigger than they used to be as well, so they're a little bit easier to see if I recall. But as far as only, if you mean getting rid of all the other data, I'd really have to dig into it to see. You would have to do a lot of manual configuration, I think, of the on-screen display. You might be able to get there or at least get close to it, really turn off almost everything else. But there you go. Charles209 is asking, should I sell my Nikon D610 and all my Nikon lenses or sell camera only and use my Nikon lenses with the GH5? Honestly, Charles, I'm always going to recommend using the Lumix lenses. There's a lot of reasons for that. Simplicity, let's just put that to start, right? No adapters, no metabones, it's just easier because it just works. Also, you will always get the highest autofocus performance with native lenses. This is something that we learned last week, and I think it came in through another question. So obviously, if you're using a Nikon lens on a Lumix body, you're going through some kind of adapter, clearly. You may or may not get autofocus. If you do, it's not going to be that fast. A question that had come up of autofocus speed performance differences between native Lumix lenses and non-Lumix but native Micro Four Third lenses. So for example, lenses from Olympus. And what came back, the answer that came back from Panasonic is that you get the fastest autofocus with native Lumix lenses, and here's why. So DFD, depth from defocusing, and that was a great explanation. I think I did a whole video on that. We're gonna link to that here. If nothing shows up there, it's because we didn't do a video. I'm pretty sure we did. A video on depth from defocusing. That depth from defocusing relies on profiles of the actual lens, how it's out of focus, how its bokeh looks, and all kinds of other stuff. But it's dedicated off of a profile of that lens. Panasonic profiles their own lenses, obviously, and therefore can do DFD or depth from defocusing off of that. This is the fastest autofocusing that you have. When you have a non-Panasonic lens, that profile does not exist, and so it doesn't do DFD because it can't. It does phase detection autofocus, which is still very fast, but DFD is faster. So that's the answer to that question as far as Lumix versus non-Lumix Micro Four Thirds lenses, and then when you go Lumix versus Nikon or any other third-party lenses that you are then adapting, you're absolutely going to get a better speed performance. Now, with that said, there may well be a lens whose look you adore, a look that you just absolutely love, or a lens that simply doesn't exist in the Lumix lineup. I don't know, you got whatever focal length at whatever aperture, you love that, does not exist on Lumix. By all means, keep the lens and adapt it. If that's something that is really important to you, then keep it. That's the beauty of the system, that you can adapt. But as far as things like a 70 to 200 equivalent, that's a 35 to 100, just get the native lenses. It's gonna be easier, you'll be happy with it overall. Okay, let's see here. Other questions? Talking about quick release plates and mounting heads and all that good stuff, excellent. We will, by the way, we will copy the entire conversation from here and post it in as a single comment on the official video, the posted video, if anyone wants to scroll through these, they're in there. Let's see here, do I use any special noise removal software for videos and stills? Well, stills, I just use Lightroom unless there's something that I want to go beyond what Lightroom can do, in which case I would use DxO Optics Pro. That is my preferred noise removal tool of choice. Also, MacFun's, MacFun's Denoise is superb, does a very, very good job as well. But the Optics Pro, DxO Optics Pro, yeah, that's right, is the one that I prefer to use. There's that. Then, Joseph has the Flex Tilthead. Oh yeah, you're talking about this thing. Is that what you guys were asking me about? I'm sorry. This thing here, the Flex Tilthead. Yeah, I have this on the slider. I love it. It's really cool. Yeah, this is a nice little add-on for the slider. So that's what you're asking about. Burns is saying, say I want to set up a slider at 45 degrees and be able to pan and shoot a landscape while sliding. So yeah, you could do by 45 degrees, like an angle like this. I can't manually do this because it's on the motor, but like that, if that's what you mean, yes. If you mean a 45-degree tilt, then I suppose you could, I don't know why you'd want to tilt it. You could do this, that would be a little bit weird. What I would not recommend is that you do this, because I think this is gonna put too much strain on the motor, and I think that would be bad. If you look at, what are these guys called? Edelkron's website, I'm pretty sure they tell you, don't do that, I think they do. I could be wrong, but I don't think that's a good idea. It sounds like a bad idea. Okay. Let's see here. Hopefully that is what you were asking for. Scott Gay says, how would I output video from the GH5 straight to my laptop so I could live stream? Would I need something external via HDMI, or would it work like a webcam? It will not work like a webcam. You do not get video out over the USB port, so you do need to do HDMI out of the camera, and this isn't unique to the GH5, it's any of them, out of the camera into some type of an adapter before going into your computer. The adapter that I recommend, we will link it below, is from Epiphan. It is the, it's just called the HDMI, I think, to USB converter. They have one that does HD, and they have a new one that does 4K as well. I own a couple of the HD ones. They work fabulously. The really nice thing, and this is why I like the Epiphan one, is it's class compliant. You don't need a driver. You just plug it in, and it works. And you get your HDMI to USB connection. And then all the software on your computer will just see that camera as a webcam. So I actually did a whole video. We'll link to that up here as well. And if we're running out of, because we can only have so many links, if you don't see a link here, scroll down below. We'll link to this one too. I did a video on a budget live broadcast setting that I set up for a client, and we used a cheap video camera, not even a DSLR type or DSLM camera, just a cheap video camera with HDMI out, and ran it through one of these Epiphan converters into a computer to turn that into a webcam, and that works really, really well. I travel with one of those, so if I ever want to do any kind of live broadcast through the computer from my camera, that's how I do it. Okay, there's that. Anamorphic questions. Oh, good Lord. Anamorphic, okay, I'm probably not going to be able to answer this, but I'll read the question anyway. Jacartons is saying, anamorphic, I have two anamorphic lenses, or a 2x anamorphic lens. Do you suggest use 4K video or 6K video for the best result? Okay, I know you put 6K video in quotes. Remember, it's not 6K video, it's 6K photo mode. I haven't done any testing with this. I don't have any anamorphic lenses. There are some really interesting ideas of what you might be able to do in 6K photo mode with an anamorphic lens and a D-squeeze and possibly getting 6K video out of it. But I haven't done any testing, certainly. That's the kind of thing that's super unique. You're going to have to test that on your own. I think it's really cool that you have options to go beyond what the camera is designed for if you get a little bit clever. Really fun. Anamorphic is fun. Anamorphic adds some really interesting flavors to the mix. So you're going to have to check it out. Basically, that's what that comes down to. I don't have a better answer for you. Okay. Oh, boy. Let's see here. Lark's Film is asking, is it possible to control focus via the app to focus pull on the GH5 for slider shots or gimbal? Okay. You can control focus on the app. You can touch the screen to focus, or you have a manual focus slider you can drag. But that is not the equivalent of a focus pull. You're not going to get a nice smooth ramp through there. It's just going to jump to focus. Now the GH5 does have a very cool focus pull feature in it where you can set two or three focus points and tap between them and have the camera go from point A to B, B to C, or whatever, at I think it's five or six different speeds, from very fast to very slow. It works beautifully. It's really, really, really cool feature. I don't know if you can trigger that. That is something I will have to look into. So if you could please repost that question as a comment, as a proper comment on this video or any other video, I'll see it and I will check that out. Don't rely on me to remember out of this feed, because I guarantee you I won't. But that's a really great question, and I want to know the answer to it too. That focus pull feature is super, super cool. I think it's really neat. Okay. Let's see here. Next up, RD John is saying that yes, you can. So, that's great if that's right, but do check it out, because I don't think RD.John has a GH5, so let me verify that, but post it as a comment. Eric Casey saying, you love my channel. Why, thank you. What is the most used lens in my arsenal of lenses? Oof. Tough question. For video or stills? Okay, for video, my main lens that I use is the 12-35. That's the 24-70 equivalent. 12-35 f2.8, that is what is on the camera 80% of the time, probably. Now, when I had the 12-60, I was using that on the GH5. I have said many times on the show that I don't know whether if I had both available, which one I would use more. That's a tough question. Right now, I have a GH5 and I don't have the 12-60, so I have to use the 12-35. So we'll see if I feel like I miss that extra reach. Obviously, with the extra reach, I'm losing a stop. So, you know, I like that f2.8 all the way through. So we'll see. For stills photography, my primary lenses are the 15 f1.7. That's a Leica lens. Love that lens. It's great street photography, focal length, nice and fast, nice shallow depth of field. Use it all the time. And then the portrait, the Noctocron lens, the 42.5 millimeter f1.2, use that one all the time. Those, and those are quite a range in between, quite a spread apart. In between, there's the 25 millimeter range, so a 50 mil equivalent. I don't use the Leica, the Panasonic Leica 25 all that much, the f1.4, because I have this now very wet as it thaws out, frozen. If you're wondering why this is wet and frozen, you're gonna have to scroll back. This is the my Zhongyi 25 f0.95 lens. Loved this lens until I broke it the other day, which hopefully I can get fixed. But this is what I use in that middle focal length. I just adore this lens. It's super shallow depth of field. It's just, it's really nice. It's really fun. And this for shooting video is gorgeous. If you know, if you can handle the super shallow depth of field, I shot a kind of a vloggy thing. I was at a concert, whatever, shot really low light. It just looked fantastic. So those are the lenses that I use the most. Another, if you're looking for just a general, what lenses would I recommend starting out for video specifically? That's easy. The 12 to 35 and the 35 to 100. Those are your two. Get those two and you've got the full range of 12 to 100, or that's 24 to 200 millimeter equivalent covered. That's a great, great starting kit. If you don't want to buy two lenses, get that 12 to 60. That's a great starting kit as well. Okay. Next up, let's see, Knook, talking about other things I don't know about. Wrong mouse again. Talking about rhinos. I don't know what the rhinoceros have to do with anything in this chat. No, I think he's talking about different tripod heads, plates, tripod heads, more comments that I cannot possibly get into. Hey, I should have said this in the beginning. I gotta remember to say this in the beginning. I gotta add it to my notes. We know about not the lower thirds, the thing, the money, the Patreon. It's going to pop up any second now because I hit the button. The Patreon thing, if you want to keep this show on the air, you can contribute via Patreon. That is a great way to do it. We also have enabled this thing called Super Chat, so you can throw in a buck and your chat comment comes up here with like stickiness to it. And it's a great way to help contribute to the channel as well. I got to start saying that in the beginning. Kind of forgot about that. But there, if you want to like throw a buck at me, that's kind of how it works. But that only works in the live thing, which is a little annoying. So anyway, there you go. Okay. Sully says, phase, oh man, I must be way behind. Phase detect, did I say phase detection? I meant contrast detection. I think that's correct. I'm sorry. You're right, Sully. I think I said phase detection. I meant contrast detection, autofocus. So yes, the GH5 does DFD. If it can't do DFD autofocus, then it reverts to contrast detection. My apologies. I said the wrong thing earlier. Okay. Let's see here. Do I prefer, just took on somebody else. Good, Sully fumbled, that's me fumbling, there you go. Okay, and yeah, we're gonna cut it. There's just so many comments come by, it's really hard to keep up with this. That's actually a really great thing to do if the whole, and I know it's money, but you know, that's fair, right? If you've got a question you really wanna have answered, throwing a buck at it, or two, or 10, or you know, 100, that's all good too, is a great way to make that question stay on the screen to make sure that I see it and get to it. So there's that. Okay. Anything else on here I wanna say? Six people talking about 6K photo, I'm gonna skip past all that. That's a whole other topic we don't wanna get into. Bernstech, I used to think that a cheap-ass camcorder was good enough, then I got a GH4, then a nice tripod, then I saw the magic of sliders, and now I'm in trouble. Oh yeah, I know. Like having this slider has been so much fun, totally in trouble. The more toys you add, the worse it gets, I swear. This is not a profession to save money. Bart says, I'll admit I'm a diehard manual focus and manual lens guy, but I did order the 12 to 35 to go with the GH5. Gonna dip my toes into autofocus and automated focus pulse. That's great. It's, you know, manual. For all the talk about autofocus, right? Autofocus is obviously fantastic on the GH5. We've seen the tests. I'm going to be doing more of them. It works really, really well. People get really excited about it. People get really worked up when they see that autofocus isn't flawless and perfect and, oh my God, it drifted out, or, oh my God, it focused on the thing in the background. Look, filmmakers don't use autofocus. Filmmakers use manual focus because they have control. You're not usually, in this case of doing proper filmmaking, it's not usually random stuff flying all over the scene. If you need to focus track a skateboarder going from A to B, odds are you're going to do it manually. You're going to have a professional focus pull it in there. You're going to rehearse the shot and you're going to pull exactly the way you go. And if you miss the shot, you're going to do it again. That's the way it works in filmmaking. Now, for run and gun, news, ENG type stuff, absolutely autofocus is fantastic. Video blogging, vlogging, autofocus, fantastic. I can't stand, Casey Neistat's got this new stupid Sony camera and he can't see the LCD. He keeps pointing the camera at himself and he's out of focus. Like, dude, get a camera that can focus, like a GH5, go figure, and with a flip-out LCD so you can verify it. I don't understand the obsession with autofocus beyond that type of environment. It's handy, but in the real world, people are using, for high-end filmmaking, people are using manual focus. That gives the filmmaker the control, not relying on the camera. Autofocus is great, absolutely has its point, purpose, place, and so on, but let's not get hung up about it. If you see an autofocus test that doesn't just wow you, blow you away, remember that that's, you may be asking for too much. Just saying. Now, with all that said, the autofocus on the GH5 is fantastic. So there. That's my soapbox. And thank you, Bart, for pointing out that you like to shoot manual, because manual is awesome. Trevor says, I like having the built-in waveform. This is the GH5. I think it may be the GH5's best feature, but it looks pretty large on the screen. Can you change the size? You can't change the size of the waveform on screen. Can you change the opacity of it? I don't remember if you can change the opacity or not, but you can't change the size of it. That's something that we did verify before. So, sorry, you can't. Any other questions in here? Yeah, you want the perfect marriage. Sully saying you ordered that lens too, the version 2 of the 12-35. You want the perfect marriage of IBS, the image stabilization. Now, that's where it becomes really, the image stabilization, that to me is far more useful than a really good autofocus. But, you know, hey, that's me. The image stabilization on these cameras is scary good. It has just gotten insanely good, whether you're shit-talking video or stills. Okay, last one on here, then I'm bailing off. Okay, RD.John is confirming or answering somebody else's question, Martin's question. I know Panasonic has pushed out details of dual IS software for the Gen 1. No, haven't looked into the others. Okay, so this is something that's come up a lot, so I'll clarify it again. Originally, Panasonic said that the Gen 1 lenses of the 12-35 2.8, these 35-100 2.8, and I think a couple others, were going to get a firmware update, to give them dual IS, dual image stabilization version 2, which is in the GH5. Then they had to backtrack on it. They issued an apology and said, we're very sorry, we were wrong. We cannot update the older hardware. The older hardware cannot handle the new technology. This is not necessarily a bad thing, though, because you still get dual version 2 whatever on the camera. It just doesn't translate through the lens as well. So you still get dual body and lens stabilization, but it's not as good as if you had the version 2 of this lens and you cannot update the firmware. The difference, though, according to Panasonic, is only about a half to one stop difference. So it's not a massive difference. It's not like going from a non-stabilized to a stabilized lens. Ooh, which actually, there's another point for that earlier question of the difference between the 35 to 100s. Let me make sure I'm saying this right. Does this have? Yeah, this 35 to 100 has built-in stabilization. So if you're on a body without stabilization, you get IS on the lens. If you're on a body with in-body stabilization, you get dual IS. This lens does not have built-in stabilization. So if your body doesn't have it, you get no stabilization. If the body has it, you get stabilization, just the body, not the body and lens. So that's another difference between these two lenses here. Okay, sorry, I'd forgotten about that one earlier. Anyway, so those older lenses will not get updated. The 100 to 400 was a new enough lens, though, that one, as far as my understanding is, that one is getting updated if it hasn't already. I think it already did. But unfortunately, these ones will not. So there's that. Okay. Whew. That's it. We're done. Bart's saying cine lenses are usually manual, so you need to manual focus. Still good for photos, but also not as good for point and shoot. Well, there you go. Cine lenses are always manual. Okay. Comments. Too many flying by. Man, that was fun. That was an hour, hour long show. Frozen lens notwithstanding. I'm so bummed. This is still such a disappointment to me. I really screwed that one up. Okay, guys. Thanks a bunch. Tomorrow's show isn't up yet, but we'll get that up soon enough. Let's see here. What can I throw you? Hey, throw this one up. If you like the photo 101s, if you like the basic stuff, please do check out my Linda 101 course. Just head to photojoseph.com/photo101. That'll redirect you to my Linda.com page, which if you're not a member of already, you can get a 10-day free trial by going to photojoseph.com/Linda. And once you're there, just search for me. But the photo 101 is a really fun, really fun course. We did that last year. And it was great. We originally photo 101 did in, 2011, I think, 11 or 12. It was when I was still with Video to Brain. We shot it in Austria. It was a really cool course, but it was quite quite bad. Like, the way it was shot was quite basic. Shot at 720p even. We redid Photo 101 from the ground up about a year ago, a little less than a year ago. It was released last summer. That's the course that I just put up on screen there. Really, really fun. That was that. We shot all 4K, although it's broadcast in 1080p on Linda. It's not 4K on Linda, but it was shot in 4K. Beautiful backdrop. We had a house down in Mendocino where we did all the shooting. It was a lot of fun. That was nice. So if you're interested in Photo 101, that's your basic, you know, how does an aperture work, that kind of stuff. It's a fun course. And, you know, even pros can occasionally learn a thing or two from those. So please do check that out. Don't forget, please do like this video if you liked it. If you didn't for some reason, don't like it, but you know, tell me why. Be nice about it. Comment, subscribe, do all that good stuff. Share it. Share the video. Sharing is good. Share it on Twitter. Share it on Facebook. Share it. You can't share on YouTube, can you? It's kind of weird. But just share far and wide. I appreciate that. And if you're going to buy anything, make sure you use the affiliate links down below. That really helps. All right. That's it, guys. Thank you so much for your time and help. And I will start. This is great. This worked out well. So I will do this again next week. Monday will be the Q&A day. And again, not every question. If they're simple questions, I'll still answer them in the comments. But if I'm going to answer it on the show, I will put a link to the show and away it will go. All right, guys. See you later. Take care. Bye-bye.